We'll get started. Okay. I have to respect everybody's time, so I get started at 4:30 sharp. Good evening. My name is Venkat. Venkatraman is my full name. Till this Monday, I've been working with InMobi, and right now I'm on a break. So this specific thing is going to talk about an organization which has evolved pretty rapidly in terms of number of people, number of releases, and stuff. So we moved from a very simplistic, so that's just the context of the thing, that we moved from a very small team and minimal releases to a big bang, hundreds of people, and close to around 100 releases at any given point of time. So that's the entire talk about. Hey. So the fact was, we said we'll move to Agile. It's pretty simple. Scrum is Agile, so that's how everybody kind of views it. So nothing else is really important. All we need is ARC, which is the artifacts, role, and ceremonies, and we just get started. So we said, okay, here are the few jargons, then you can kind of sell it out in the organization and can, you know, get started, and all the teams get started. So that's the typical thing, and I don't have much to cover. I'll just, since it's a case study, I'm going to kind of walk you through what the organization, how is it structured, what did we try to do? And as somebody was pointing out in the morning, it's all about experimentation. It is not that you keep experimenting at somebody else's cost, but then when you say experiment, it's you're going to be taking care of finding out whether that experiment really worked, do you want to really proceed in the direction, and things like that. So that's all what I'm going to talk about. And when we say scaling Agile, this entire theme is about scaling Agile adoption. So we had scaled Agile, we also had adoption challenges. So I'm going to cover both of them. Couple of recommendations that I'll have in the end, which are not generic recommendations. They sound generic, they are very commonsensical, but then there are specific reasons why those recommendations have only been put up. So the organization overview is like this. So I incidentally read somebody's quote saying, if this organization is not cross, if your organization in Agile is not cross-functional, you are dysfunctional. Agreed to an extent, but I wouldn't give it to that fully, given the fact that for over two and a half years, or close to 2 years, 9 months, we worked with a non-cross-functional team. It released hundreds and hundreds of feature requests that really need to get out of the organization. For all you know that, we had really the need of being this way. So the reason to put it this way is also the fact that that's how the organization is structured. Each of them, the reason why I'm stressing this also is this is the picture that you have to have in mind when I'm going to talk through the entire session. That's very easy for you to then relate what I'm talking about. This means that they have, to the ratio of this to this, the team size is a little different, which means it's a workflow. You get in, create a campaign, trying to kind of, you know, go all the way till billing. There is a clear workflow which happens, and every single team, right from a UI team, or be it the serving team, and be it the data team, be it the billing team, everybody is what you see out here. And there are slides which will come up as to what we tried and what we had really finally landed up with, and it worked fine with us. And as the organization has changed, we are now becoming a lot more cross-functional, or we kind of ended up saying, let's go cross-functional because that's much easier for us to take care of the portfolio. Now, project, program, and portfolio, some color of the same diagrams. So just that, try to kind of, you know, give you a perspective. Each of the lines out here, the red, green, amber, is nothing to say about the status of the project. They are, what I'm trying to talk about is feature releases, which this team, this and that team really need to kind of, you know, work together to really make things happen. That's the way of how you look at the releases. Similarly, here is, this is how it goes. Now again, the diagram doesn't talk about who does what, and, you know, who goes first to production and who goes next to production and things like that. In a complete chain of events as to workflow, who actually lights up in production, who consumes, who's a producer. So each of the team becomes a producer consumer by itself. Now, that's always going to be the case when you are in a non-cross-functional team. You will have somebody who's a producer, will have somebody a consumer, and then you will have to kind of, you know, coordinate between the teams. So, and for this, managing this, I'll let you know that I was there, and there are two more team members. And I'll tell you the number of engineers, number of people who are working there when we get to that particular slide. So just giving a perspective that if you set your framework, if you set your things relatively light and simple, all you need to do is to just get the teams motivated to move in that particular direction. Now, what do we talk about a portfolio and program and project? A project for us was primarily to do with saying very siloed within a single team. There could be releases which are very tech-related releases, where you know enhancing or you know moving on to a next version of Hadoop, moving on to a next version of you know the database or things like that, or moving scaling your system within your own single team. That's going to be a more or less like a project for you. A program is could be something like an SDK. You want to ship an SDK, which is like a program for yourself. It's not. It's one of the releases within a big portfolio. So that's what we typically call the program. And a portfolio. Portfolio is nothing but all the 70, 80 releases or the feature releases that we typically did at any given point of time. And when I'm telling you that there are 80 feature releases that are running, feature request, or you can call that to be typically, which are running, they are running in execution state. They're not in different states of operation. They're in an execution state, and the number is around 80 plus. So that's the typical portfolio cutting across 10 different themes of the portfolio. Now, given that's the case, started off with some executive expectations saying we need predictability into all the 80. This is the number of releases that we are working, but then we need predictability. If not 80, at least I want 80% of the 80 releases to be having clear predictable dates. Build credibility because of the predictability being low, the credibility with the business teams or the field facing teams where the field commits something to the other person saying this feature is going to come out in the next 3 weeks and there is going to be a slippage. You have to communicate back to the field. The field is the person who's facing the customer and the customer is going to be very unhappy with it. So there is credibility loss within the company itself and not just outside. Provide visibility into what's happening, which means to say at any given point of time, where will I find information? So again, this is a startup growing at what 45 engineers and close to around 200, 250 people in the organization. That's when I'm talking about the executive expectations. And manage the dependencies that we saw in the last slide in terms of what we need to do. And the challenges. And we always, Pete Diemer also says, and a lot of other people say, you know, start with a pilot project. Now, in this case, I don't have a pilot. I can't pick up team D and say, let's go agile. You know, let's do your backlog, let's do sprint and stuff. What happens to the rest of the people? They're all chaotic. They will be working in their own stuff. They wouldn't know. So there is no opportunity whatsoever, except for one or two teams who had very minimal work that we could kind of negotiate and get it done. There was no possibility of picking up a pilot team. So it is like launch it across the 45 people at one go, which is like six teams. 45 people, six teams at one go. Okay, who all do we need in the release? So when I joined, I was the first project management hire. I called in a person saying, let's talk about this release. He'll say, I'll call that person also. Then he brings in. Third person would say, he's also required for this because the end point is that guy. So it became into a point where we started to do a searching of people to see which who all need to contribute. Now, it doesn't mean that that's how the organization should be when you are in a pretty startup mode. You know, you kind of huddle, you decide something that you would do, and then you move on to your desks and you start working. But somebody needs to really tie these pieces together when you are having 15 releases at any given point of time. I'm talking about 2011 June. I made this change long back. I'm too aware of it. So the code was lying. According to Lean principle, anything that's not being used is a waste, which means somebody has done the code, shipped it into even SVN or Git, but it's never been pushed to prod. It's just sitting right there. This is my overall priority, but this is my team's priority. So when you saw those number of teams, the reason why I asked you to memorize the diagram, this is the overall priority of the feature release, but then my team is working on something else. I have clarity on my team's work, not sure when it's being done in the other teams. This requirement is not yet frozen. So we didn't want to pick it up till the time somebody really gives it. Too many meetings. Somebody had kind of told the organization or anybody who's working, I'm saying, oh, we're moving to Agile, which means half the time we'll be spending in meetings. So that's the typical mentality people came in with. So I had to really write an email to people saying, here's what you would spend in a week. Here's what you spend in a day, beyond which you won't find any meetings in your calendar. And really, people started to believe when their calendars looked empty. And we also started to set certain timelines by saying, let's not put any meeting between 11 and 3. Let people work whatever they want to. If you want to have any meetings, we'll do it a little bit above and beyond that. I just merged this into a trunk. You want me to roll back? Which means say, oh, you guys haven't picked it up. I have just rolled it into my main branch. So these are the certain challenges that we face because of the problem of no pilots. Because it's not like we can't get everything in. We have to bring people together and make this. Again, I've mentioned things which are not probably uncommon. It's more or less what happens at work for you. So the meta issues that started to kind of, you know, realize was no firmed up prioritization criteria as well as prioritization. So there were people in the organization who really are kind of in the front ending with the field. So they used to kind of give the prioritization saying, if you don't do this, we are not going to have a good face in front of these things. We're going to lose this particular account. We're going to lose this. We're going to lose that. So all that prioritization came up overly, and there is no specific criteria, which is return on investment as a criteria, or be it number of dollars, which is going to be saved, and things like that is going to be the criteria. Then there were other meta issues, such as changing technical contracts between teams once finalized. And now the word contracts was little, we had to put it in, because once the producer has decided a contract, a consumer has to kind of adhere to it. Similarly, when that guy becomes a producer, the next guy is a consumer, he needs to adhere to the contract. So the word contract was actually put it in place in 2011, saying it's not going to be an agreement, it's purely a contract between you guys. You need to kind of ensure that you adhere to it. Technical infrastructure, not really there. Some teams were really doing it, some teams weren't doing it. So we had to kind of standardize, saying everybody gets onto Jenkins, build has to come from Jenkins. So operations had to put their foot down, saying unless the build comes from Jenkins and I have a link, I'm not going to push it into production. So it started from there. Of course, they became the really bad guys in one of the meetings and saying operations are like putting us too much of pressure and stuff. We said, let's do this for 2 months. Let's see. Let's experiment. We started to use the word. Let's experiment. And then the moment they saw the production bugs coming down, the number of rollbacks in the production coming down, the operations started to publish data saying 2 months back, here is the number of rollbacks. 2 months later, because of Jenkins, here is the less number of rollbacks. People started to believe it, and they started to make it a way of life. The moment a new project started, first thing is they'll assign a guy to sit next to them, finish up the Jenkins setup, and then they'll try to get that particular thing. Communication within the team and beyond the team, these are all meta issues, and goal of the organizations versus goal of the team. You call this in Corbett, one of the nice thing as, cascade, goals cascade. So you need to have the goal of the organization really cascading to the goal of the team. Otherwise, what happens? They're all siloed. Somebody talked about the silo. Harry talked about it, right? Remove the silos. Otherwise, what happens? Everybody is sitting in one corner of the place. They have nicely taken the process to their suiting their needs, saying, 10 days you told me you won't disturb me because we are on a sprint. Now, let's not talk about it. I'll talk to you in the next sprint. So that's not the what point we're trying to talk about. Guys, if there is something that's going to break the goal of the organization, you continue doing something else, it's going to really be not really working well. And missing the big picture, which means to say, everybody who's actually in that columns that you saw on those teams were only focused saying, I will take care of my stuff. I really don't know where it's going to affect. Who's going to be pushing it to production? I have no clue. I have pushed it. As he said, I have pushed it. Now it's operations case. Even now, there are certain pockets where people would kind of go and do that. We keep saying, sorry, you wrote the code. You are responsible for it on production. Operations will help you to push it. They will help you to get your graphs ready. They'll help you to get your monitoring ready. Sorry, they're not going to be owning your code. So the guy who's on the on-call really gets woken up, and not the ops guy. Both of them are sitting at the on-call at 2 a.m. if there is a problem. So that's how we have kind of taken care of the big picture. Visibility. This is the reason to put a couple of stars, and I have few other stars coming in. Many times, you think that too much visibility. Let's take this room, bloat it with post-its and bloat it with graphs, burn down charts and everything. Without the people really knowing what it means, it's like going into an art gallery, which is a modern art. I'm not joking about it. The people walking and saying, that burn down is not good. Which team is it? It's like saying, don't even come to them. They have their own problems. They are blocked on some other team. You have to stand and explain. The person has set up a perception in his mind. The senior management has set up a perception in the mind saying, the burn down is bad. Second time he sees the burn down same way, this team is really not doing good. Of course, the team is actually really, really doing good. But just that you're not able to interpret the graph correctly in terms of what they're trying to do. They are blockers, which only the teams know, and they are working on it. So visibility too little was the concern that was raised when I joined. And visibility too much suddenly became a point of comparing two teams' burn downs. Right? So you need to educate. I didn't have the time to really go ahead and educate every single guy in the organization. We had to do a lot of things on the job because we were just running full steam in terms of what we need to do. So at that period of time, you need to do that, unlearn and relearn, and a lot of stuff that needs to really happen. Lack of simple process to tie the entire piece together was clearly there. So a lot of people had already been on 1 week sprints, but then their sprints were very different. They just push everything, whatever is ready by that end of the week. And it wasn't a committed thing that really went out. So if something slipped, there was not being even communicated. There was not a process to clearly do, this is the way we will do. Some people skip code reviews. Some people had code reviews very diligently. That was blocking a lot of stuff. And that guy wasn't even aware that the code review was sitting on him. So these are the typical meta issues that we have found. And one other thing that came out is, what is the value of doing this versus that? So which is not just the prioritization value. I'm talking about, why should I do this? Why should I update the APLM tool? What is the value of doing this versus what I was doing before? A lot of other common queries. We are just fine. Why Agile? I mean, we don't need anything. We're like doing every week. We are doing releases. So there's a lot of resistance in the organization. I'm a developer. I'm not sure when will this hit production. Maybe ops will know. A couple of things which ideally we spoke about. Why is team burned down things? So the first and foremost thing that was done is to do with gap identification, which means to say there is inter-team dependencies. There are two guys whom you saw. It's not about people issues, but then since they had their own task stuff, but they're checking into the same code base, and they're not talking on a daily basis. Inter-team dependencies, because he has to either merge on top of the other guy, or that guy has to merge on top of him. Absolutely no communication till the date really came close, and they kind of put their hands up saying, we have not merged. So that slipped. Cascading effect, because he is a consumer, he is a producer. So the consumer slips, further consumer slips, it just moves on. This release, because this guy is delayed, he was planned in some other release, that's also going to get delayed continuously. Intra-team dependencies, we spoke about. Visibility at all levels, figuring out, because this was causing a lot of perception, which had to kind of, you know, be broken by regular status reports and stuff, which is very minimal. No funky MS project reports and stuff. It's a plain simple Excel that was used for 6 months. Just simple Excel for managing, because we had no walls, unfortunately, to do post-its. The walls were very away from even touching, because there was cabins and stuff, which was a little, the office space was not set up for Agile. And it was a rented office, all that stuff was a problematic, breaking down walls. So wherever we could find, we used to go ahead and block the room and kind of do the whiteboarding. So that's something there. And the plan of the record, which is what I was trying to talk about, a single unified view of all the 15, 20 releases, where are they? Are they in, so we had multiple states of things. One is called in, you call it, the number of the release states were also defined, because a lot of people saying, whoa, nobody has started coding on it, but how are we going to say it is an execution? So we had to define certain states and saying, we pipeline the release for approval. The approval is done by the chief product officer or the product head, also with the chief engineering guy. Say, this is now approved. We get it into ideation. I'll show you the couple of people who will be involved in it. And then it moves into execution. It moves into under review. And then it moves into closed. Which means these are the specific, we also had to write up and educate people saying, you're not in execution right now. Let's not call this and create more panic out there. So there's a lot more processes, well, lightweight processes that had to be set up. And again, none of the Scrum or XP or anything talks about these things. I'm just trying to talk about, these are all peripheral program management office things that you still need to do, even being an Agile company, given the fact that this can kind of ruin your entire rollout. If they're not convinced that you're doing a correct job or you're giving them the visibility, no support. Absolutely no support. You'll be on your own. You're going to be kind of, you know, burning all fingers. Agile Scrum training and gradual adoption focused on a critical few first. When I say critical, those teams, if they delay, because as somebody said, right, it took 2 days for deployment. We had a similar situation. Now the deployment is 3 hours. Of course, it requires 3 hours because we have 7 different sites where the deployment servers need to be brought down and brought up. So that's also being worked on, that it'll be becoming one click install. So all that stuff need to be really doing going ahead. Now, I'll just stop here and kind of give you a perspective of what all experiments we tried. We move into the experiment part, right? Now that we saw the team diagram, we had multiple ABC, cross-functional, non-dysfunctional teams. Cross-functional teams, so we had to try a lot of approaches in terms of how they will work. First thing was a virtual team, trying to say, here is the PM who will write up the release, the product owner in terms of Agile. The product manager will write up the release, PRD, provide a clear survey, I mean, clear success criteria and stuff like that. The architect plus PM plus a couple of leads who are on the team. Again, non-hierarchical doesn't work. In India, let's be very honest about ourselves. We still have titles. We still have the groups. What we're trying to say is we don't want to bring the entire team to this meeting, right? So these three people really sit and understand when we say stack. So you looked at those stacks, right? The diagram that I was trying to talk about. These three people really sit and think about which all teams will contribute to this Redis. And then they kind of break it out into the stories. So this becomes an epic. These are all the stories under the epic. Automatically, if you see, this gets auto-populated into the team's backlogs. So the moment you create a story on team A, that goes into team A backlog, team B backlog, team C. So if you really look at it, team A's backlog is an a la carte. So if you go and order for a roti basket, that's how they get it. They're not kind of in a product teams. They are not feature teams. They are actually a team who's actually churning out in terms of how you want to kind of, you know, get the feature releases really out. Now, this has changed over the last 3-4 months in terms of how we need to do it, but as a case study, I'm trying to represent as to how we had to do it. And I had no chance of kind of, you know, reworking this to a feature teams. And we tried that also. I'll show it in the next slide. What happens is the auto pushes to the stack sprint backlog. They get to done. Whenever the teams really get to done, these virtual teams actually used to sit together in their cubicles, and one person from here, this each of them is a release by itself, and they get to do. Next is, we said stack sprints, which means to say, all of them, when each stack completes, they'll just go ahead and make dark releases into production. We'll try to kind of, you know, not have the virtual teams. They'll be all siloed. They'll only meet when, initially when their requirements are going to be clarified, but then they're on their own. They have their own 10 days sprints. They'll come back and let us know. Let the PMO team will coordinate in terms of when the things would be deployed to production. Might be dark releases, which means to say nobody's consuming that API, but my API is live. When you start consuming, it'll work. This was the other approach that we tried to do, given that a lot of people had raised the noise and saying, I'm attending too many, in this case, I'm attending too many virtual team meetings. Like the same developer is sitting on 3 releases and he says, I'm attending 3 meetings in a day, I don't want to do that. I want to just do my teams, my stacks, stand up. And I'll give you the update, PMO team will take care now. So that's one of the approach. Second approach was stack sprints. Now it's not that all three, I'm going to show you the next one, all three was done in like today morning, then we scrapped this and did this next day morning, and then we scrapped it and say Monday morning we'll do it differently. No, it was done over a period of 2 years. We had to try experimenting multiple hybrid models that really worked. Each of them had their own glitches. I'll explain to you as to why, what happened in this case. In this case, as I said, the biggest advantage was that they could work together, they had the common goal of the release, they understood what the release is all about, and they could work together. The other disadvantage is the same guy, if he has just 2 days of work in a sprint, he will be working on 4 different things, right? Which eventually he will still work on even in the stack sprint, but then he will be working, he or she will be working on 4 different things, and he has to attend 4 different standups, which means to say, you know, 1 hour, 1.5 hours is going to be in the meetings and things like that, again, it's 15 minutes. The next one had a problem where there was a lot of C-load approach. Like, I am done, and then it's all falling. If I have to take 10 days off, I had really had 3 members in my team, and it goes for a big task because I was not there to coordinate, so I have to rely on the engineering manager to take care of stuff. Everybody, again, looked in the T approach, they looked at their depth. The breadth was not very much considered because the incentivization was also not very clear on terms of whether it's a T or a, you know, it's going to be the breadth. So you're always going to be very, very focused on your team. You're going to be taking care of your team, and you're still going to be kind of raising flags in terms of how you really want this to be. So we arrived finally at something to do with a mix of both, which means to say, of course, there will be sprints, which will be stack-based sprints. There'll also be virtual sprints, virtual teams. They can sit in their locations, but then we will have release-based stand-ups, which then will not be on a daily basis. It might be twice a week. Given the fact that then we started to use a lot of other communication mechanisms, like we currently are on Jira, we said people have to extensively start communicating there, but it is mandatory for everybody to attend that release stand-ups that happen you know, every at least twice a week to raise any flags. Usage of communication in terms of messengers, in terms of saying, I'm blocked, who's going to unblock me, or call out clearly saying, hey, team B's, this particular person is, or you create, you know, specific chats which are going to be doing that. So we kind of worked around that particular piece, given the fact that that's how the organization is structured. You have to work around it. Either you kind of break it completely and say, we'll make feature teams, and then every problem will be solved under the sun. Now, when I talked about this grouping, right, one thing that I'm just latching onto what Harry also said, we made sure operations was part of, dev QA was anyway part of the team, but operations was part of the sprint plan. Operations team were part of the sprint planning. They started to love it because they knew what was coming. They went ahead and even ahead of it, they went ahead and coolly did all the monitoring in place, kept their graphs ready. The moment data started to flow, the graph started to populate. Within an hour of production push, they used to come back and say, breaking, we are either rolling back or rolling forward. Who's going to push it? So that particular thing was not happening before. Operations took their own time. They were not even aware. They were just given one ticket saying, push this to production. And then they kind of were the bottleneck and saying, we are not able to understand what you're trying to do. Why are you making us kind of do this? So slowly, in over a 6-month period of time, operations were part of the sprint planning. And now they are part of the team. So that's how we try to kind of, you know, do in terms of what we need to do. And we use both push and pull, which means to say, in this case, this becomes your push, which pushes to the backlog. And the pull is going to be on the Kanban thing that you just probably, whoever was hearing the other side in the ballroom. We also had, so we still use Scrumban, which is what we are trying to talk about. Scrumban is how we are using Scrumban. Most of you would know what Scrumban is, but then what Scrum plus Kanban, what we're trying to do is, we're doing a push, which means say the release comes up, PM writes up the release, the teams break it out into stories, pushes automatically to the backlog, right? This is your sprint backlog, this is all your sprint backlogs, and maybe this is your product backlog, or you can call the team backlog. Eventually out of this, you will do a sprint backlog. So team A might have 40 items coming from 10 different releases. They'll pick up the top 10 or 12, which they need to really develop. That's what the sprint backlog would become. Now, when they really start their sprint, that becomes an engineering focused stuff, is where they'll start using their Kanban board in terms of trying to see where the bottleneck is. Many a times, the developer is also very busy, and he or she is not able to do the code reviews. So code review gets into a little bit of, it doesn't move for ready for QA until, so this was one of the things, snapshot, I took it out, but a lot of people are saying waiting for code review, waiting for QA, waiting for deployment. So code reviews were starting to get the blocker. So we clearly said, moment a code review pull request in Git comes in, whoever has been assigned or who's actually free has to pick it up. Or in the stand-up, we kind of discuss that saying, guys, this has not been picked up, somebody has to pick it up. So they immediately kind of put their hands up and saying, I'll do the code review on this. My code review somebody needs to do, the guy will say, I'll do yours. So it just goes in that fashion, so we can kind of minimize that number of work in progress limits that we had to clearly get there. All of you would be able to see that it's all infinity right now. This is a snapshot taken pretty long back where we did not have any WIP limits. I think even James, the Kanban person, clearly Anderson says that it's a Kanban without a work in progress limit is no Kanban. So, but at least we had to kind of get the board up for people to visualize, make it visible. That's the whole important idea behind what we're trying to look at. So talked about this theme is about scaling adoption, right? So, scaling agile. The duration, what I'm talking about in the case study is between Q4 2011 through Q4 2013. The team members moved from 60 to 200 in a span of 2 years. The company had 200 million funding. So we had a lot of ambitious goals given by the board. So the teams, I'm talking only about the engineering plus technology, which is ops in terms of it. There are still people about architects and a lot of other people who are part of this 200 plus if you want to really take it. Team size, teams increased from 6 teams to 14 teams. Because we started to have new business lines, a lot of new portfolios, so new teams were formed. Existing people, two, three people are migrated and new people are hired so that they knew the system. PM team increased from 4 to 10. So naturally, you're going to have more feature releases coming in. Everybody's going to write their own 5 or 6 PIDs asking, I want to get this done. So eventually, when we sat actually in a quarter to really review, there were 130 asks parked. I really had to do a filtering for 2 days to really get it down to, say, 45. Saying rest of them is not going to be done in this quarter. And out of that 45, eventually 22 got prioritized and got into the queue. So that's the PM team increases. Consequently, the number of releases moved from 15 to 45 to 80. So scaling is not just one directional, right? So here is a team scaled, number of teams scaled, PMs scaled, and the number of releases suddenly started to bloat up. And they were brought under different business lines. So one business guy is unhappy that his thing is not getting serviced. in multiple forums, people make a noise saying, yeah, yeah, all love goes to that the portfolio A. I don't get any love. So immediately the next day meeting would be called saying, how can we kind of, you know, make two or three of these, this portfolio B items prioritized? So there is a dynamic prioritization change there, which we had to fight out from a perspective saying, you guys are stopping it midway. There's going to be a lot of flurry. There's going to be a lot of flutter happening. Let's kind of, you know, take it cool. The reason for portfolio B not being happening is XYZ. Let's not kind of, you know, take one instance of a meeting to kind of, you know, change course and things like that. So the good news is that the first framework that we had just put out saying there'll be a PM who writes up the stories and just gets into the backlog and gets moving, seamlessly scaled, any number of teams added, any number of people added, it just moved on. No changes were done except for the fact, as I said, engineering practices were expedited because that became a super, super bottleneck for us. Builds taking time, all the other stuff, you know, including continuous integration taking time, all the stuff really were the fundamental problems more than prioritization or backlogs or the team. So that's one part of it. And what's the current focus is value-driven prioritization, given the fact that there are 10 product managers and even more. You can't have 130 items. Somebody has to kind of really do that value-based prioritization, saying, this has a higher value than that. Give me that particular value. Then you win. Otherwise, you're not winning in this particular meeting. Capacity, visibility, and planning. Given the fact that you'd be surprised saying, why was the capacity not being really bothered about? What we ended up doing was relied on the team to say, here is a 10-member team. Here is your backlog. Here's the priority, let's get started. And we did not do we started not look at burn downs. We started to focus very heavily on done, which is good to say, are you pushing it to production? Has the code review done? So it's more towards to do specifically non-tool based. Tool had the story in it, but we weren't looking at the burn downs and saying, why is the burn down low? And after a period of time, the teams themselves stopped to look at the burn downs. They started to rely more on team communications and in terms of, you know, how the releases were being pushed to production faster, how the dates were being met, and it went into a point of how fast the teams are able to operate. Align teams to business units, that's exactly what we were trying to look at. Continuously improve engineering practices. This is something that I can't be without stressing. I mean, that's 80%, I'll stand here and tell that 80% of blockers were due to engineering practices and engineering blockers. Product managers were very hardly mentioned in terms of they being the blocker. Every single engineer had anything to do with the engineering being the particular blocker, nothing else. Adapt Scrumban across the entire organization, and I'll show you the 6-sprint planning that we're trying to talk about. Now, we could come back and say it breaks Agile, saying, why should I plan for 6 sprints, all right? I should always be working on freshly looked at sprints every single minute. What we're trying to look at here is not planning. When I say it's not committing for 6 sprints, it's about committing for the first or maximum 2 sprints and bucketing for the next 6 sprints, next 4 sprints. The reason is you really do not have, otherwise we have land up in the same problem. I don't know when that other team is going to pick up. I really don't know when I will be done here, but I really don't know when this guy is going to pick it up. I really don't know when this team N is going to pick it up. So what we had to do eventually was we had 2 sides of the wall in the room. On one side, we said, write all the epics, write all the stories. Stories were on team A, B, C, and D. And believe me, I would probably recommend this very heavily because it worked. Almost everybody who came into the room and left thanked my team, as well as they were talking about it for months to come, saying, that particular meeting, I would love to have it next quarter. I'll explain to you how this particular slide, I'll stop here and explain a little bit because this is something that you can even do irrespective of where, you know, what kind of teams you have and things like that. It's very, very essential that when you have especially dependencies, making this kind of a plan and this kind of an execution is going to help you out. Trust me, this will not remain the same in 3 days. Agreed. But you already have, you at least have something on the wall. Rather than somebody giving you orally and committing saying, I'll pick it up next sprint. And you will think saying next sprint starts on 20th. So it's going to start 20th. No. And then you'll have to follow up with him on the next sprint. Now what they're doing is they're at least putting something on the wall. And they're going to give you, if something moves, you're going to be knowing that something is moving. What happens is on one side, you take the epic, 14 epics or 15 epics, whatever you want to. make all the team A, B, N stories, whichever teams are going to contribute. Then take those pieces up on basis of the priority, take the other wall and make the team-based allocations and move the, each of the story to this side. Eventually what happens is you will you will get up, all these are story, this is a story for release one, this is a story for release two. You can see that release one is being done here, but it's not being picked up by these two teams here because release two probably was extremely important for the team. So they had, I'm just giving, I could have put on like 10 stories out here to complicate stuff, but I'm just giving you a pictorial view. Now what happens is, at least for you, this becomes your Gantt chart. For people who have been in the traditional side of things, and even Agile, I'm not saying that you shouldn't use Gantt charts. I'm saying this becomes your clean Gantt chart. It finishes and goes out here, maybe there's an end-to-end happening at that end. So you clearly know that when my sprint three, which is going to be 45 days from now, is when this release is going to light up. That's your probable 50 to 70% confidence timeline if this plan is executed. Now, when do we do this? We do it once when you get a set of priority from the product, you do a particular meeting, and then there are 40 or 30 releases which have been approved for execution. You take that, you do this planning. Now, things would change when this guy, for example, could not take up release one here. It slides down. You kind of figure out, then kind of do this exercise week on week with that particular person, make sure the communication comes back to you. So this is a very simplistic Excel-based thing that you could do. Of course, the translation, I mean, all of this would be eventually in your own Agile lifecycle management tools. But I'm talking about first one-day planning with all people in the room. When I say all, at least the engineering managers or the leads in the room, trying to get a perspective based on t-shirt sizing in terms of how long would they take. Would they take release one? Is it going to be one sprint work or is it going to be two sprint work? I've just not depicted two sprint work. I'm just saying, if it's going to be one sprint work or two sprint work, they'll come back and tell you. Because a simple thing, right? There's a, one of the teams always used to have 2 to 3 days of work. That's all. In a, any release, their number of their work is maximum 2 to 3 days. So they always will finish it within a sprint. But there are teams who will take 3 weeks. Some teams would take even 6 weeks, given the fact that they have to make a service. The service needs to be then kind of, you know, consumed by somebody else, and then they have to really validate, get the data, make a lot of UI changes. That team owned both the UI as well as the service. So it took them like 3 to 4 weeks. So they will not be able to finish it within one sprint. They'll be able to finish it only in two sprints. So they come and give back. Either they break that story into multiple stories, which can be consumed within the sprints. And then they show you saying, this is release one, this is release one, again here. This is a story of release one. So this is, again, I just put out a simplistic one. You could do it on a whiteboard. I mean, post it. You don't need to really use a tool. But eventually, you can translate it here for tracking because the post-its won't remain in your room forever. So I'm moving on to the recommendations. I'll take questions at the end of it. First things first, if you don't have this, whatever you can do in the world can never kind of, you know, succeed. For that, you really need to know, you have to consistently get the buy-in from them. It's not like you have handed over the baton to you and you can do whatever you want to. It's consistently that you need to kind of, you know, get the buy-in by finding out what exactly are they looking at, what data really they need, what data you need to project, educate the people in terms of what it needs to be. Solve the right problems and think what you think the problems are, right? And you go and put 50 different dashboards for the consumption of the team, but the exec is completely not happy with it. They want a different dashboard, which gives them a confidence level in terms of something is really happening, is what you need to be. And there will definitely be criticisms and feedback, so you need to be really be taking them with an open mind, as well as with a lot of, at times with a lot of pinch of salt, where you know that they're not coming in with the right data. They're probably having perception, so you have to go and beat the perception by giving them the right data. As we saw it, right, so there were just glimpses of the experiments that we did. There's quite a bit of experiments that we had to do from a perspective of what we need to do. Choose the best that works for you. Keep it, you know, make things happen. That's the whole point, right, saying, just because you don't believe in it, saying, hey, this won't work, and somebody else doesn't believe in it, you can't just drop the ball. You have to kind of convince them to say, let's try this. So some teams really came to me and said, Scrum isn't working for us. Can we go Kanban? I cannot do something in 2 weeks. You're making me split a story. So for even be it Rally or be it Jira, be it any other tool, if the story has dev tasks and QA tasks and stuff, and dev and QA cannot finish it within a sprint, you have to make two stories. Because the stories cannot span between sprints. It's only the task that will span. So you'll go and make part one, part two. And people wonder, what is part one, part two? So the, all these answers you have to kind of, you know, make sure that you have in your mind and say the tool doesn't support. So they allow a perception about the tool itself, saying the tool is not good, man. So the fact is, all these perceptions you have to beat in terms of trying to, so you have to experiment, saying, guys, you want Kanban? Okay, fine. Given that it has no boundaries, but now, when you are going Kanban, I need clear dates from you. Because you're not time bound. You can't take a story and tell me no date on the story. So there is, you have to kind of, you know, do that experimentation, do that play with them, make it happen. You know, if they want it, you have to give it to the team. Because if you don't give it to them, they're going to always feel it, saying, this guy is thrusting something on me. I'm not going to be happy about it. Focus on architecture and design. This is one thing which is, you know, seriously missed out. You always end up after coding, suddenly it breaks and say, realize saying, our system was not scaled for taking this traffic. This QPS is what we can support. This boxes support this QPS. This is not going to be beyond this. Nobody had thought through saying this architecture or this particular stuff does not scale beyond X number of traffic hits on this particular box. So that's something that we need to talk about it. General recommendation is that you have your architects think about every major release that's happening. Work left shift, which means to say you do a spike sprint, you need to understand certain graphs. They'll do some kind of a tweaks. They'll make a call to the new Hadoop API. All that stuff they will try to do and say, this works, this doesn't work. For this to happen, it will take us 2 weeks. So you cannot release anything within 2 weeks till we go live. So all that stuff, you need to coordinate with the architects who might not be part of the engineering team. In many organizations, they are part of the separate technology organization. You need to work with them, bring them ahead, try to kind of, you know, do that particular left shift for them, give them that particular bandwidth. Don't commit anything without they giving a sign off. That's one of the reasons why you saw it's a PM, architect, engineering person, all three together discuss whether this is scalable or not scalable. The moment you drop the architect from the equation, you're going to be running into a problem later. And they'll say, it never came to me. Nobody kind of told me. I would have told you immediately that it won't scale. So these kind of things we should kind of, you know, avoid. The other one is, yeah, enough spoken by Harry. I don't want to kind of, you know, talk about it. There's a very nice article which has been written in the site called dev2ops.org. It's called the wall of confusion. So just finish something, throw it to the other end. Keep throwing. And then they will kind of catch it and they'll push it something and something will break. Everything completely goes loose. So unified vision, but individual goals. You cannot have an engineering goal being thrust on an operations goal. For them, uptime of 99.xxx, whatever it needs to be, is their key goal. Engineering does not probably have that goal. They have X number of defects less, or you know, zero defects and a lot of other stuff. Operations, why should they be measured on a zero defect goal? Right? So they'll be measured on their uptime. So they're more worried about you shipping zero defect code, right? So there are a lot of these things happening. So you have a unified vision in terms of keeping this uptime. In order to keep this uptime, everybody has to have a unified vision, but at the same time having individual goals that needs to be there. And Brad, don't touch this, it's my territory. You know, many times ops won't give you any access as a pseudo access. That becomes a holy grail. Basically, somebody will be really annoyed if you ask them for access into the production boxes. That mentality I've seen over at least 6-7 years in multiple organizations. It's very hard to break because you feel very close to heart that I have admin access. I mean, I'm a Jira admin. I don't feel anything about it. It's a burden on me because every time there's a small field that has to be created, it'll come to me. It has some new user has to be added, it'll come to me. So it's not a very enjoyable job to have an administrative rights and being very happy about it. It's just a matter of, you know, not my territory. No, it's your territory. You need to understand what's happening on the other side also. Shift left, which means to say bring them in. Get the operations guy also in the sprints. Get them even working ahead saying, hey, you know what? We need an upgrade of Scribe. We need an upgrade of the XYZ open source stuff. Can you guys work ahead of it and try to get this for us? Collaborate. I mean, I don't want to kind of, you know, focus on problems and people. Many a times it happens that there are people perceptions that lead to, you know, I don't want to talk to this guy, so I don't want to code merge. And I don't want to talk about it till somebody really pushes him or me hard to really go and do a code merge on top of each other. So that's not what we really want to do that. Again, as I said, right, many of the recommendations are very common sense, but then these I found as fundamental barriers to really get things moving in an agile organization. Quality, which is one article in Scrum Alliance, one of our major sponsors. Please go read about an article written on definition of done. It's very beautiful. Beautifully given the entire gamut of stuff that needs to really happen. Measure, which means to say, just keep that, keep it pretty simple in terms of what you want to measure. You don't want to kind of go and give every single Gantt chart, every single burn up, all that, you know, all the jargons just because you want to show you are agile. You don't need to really do it. This is one of the nice things that you could look from. So many things that you could do and give people as a metrics. Just to please people saying, I have like, I will give you a nice weekly report which has 15 different metrics. Who's looking into it? Nobody. At the end of it, if you look at it, test coverage, escape defects, performance, defect ingestion, story point, velocity, available capacity, stretch factor, time spent versus bugs versus feature, what is your cycle time? Of course, cycle time is important in our cases where we want to understand when the release really came in and when the release started in execution and when the last guy really pushed code to production. Team A started to work first, but team D is the final guy who pushed to production is our cycle time. We want to kind of really look at those kind of metrics. Then at portfolio level, executives might want to look at a pie chart in terms of saying, in this portfolio, how much of ours are being used up? Are we really getting the return on investment on that? Is a 50-member team really required to do this portfolio? Is only 20-member required? All that stuff would really come in. Of course, these slides will be available, I believe, so you don't need to note it on this. Especially is a crowdsourced thing that I had used. So I want to give the credit to a lot of people who would have joined to this crowdsource in Agile Bootcamp that really happened. Keep them visible, which is what even the last session on Kanban was trying to talk about, saying keep them visible. If you want to show a problem, keep them visible. That's extremely important. Out of sight is out of mind, which means to say if you don't put that blocker out on the page or block it, you're not going to be bothered. Unless otherwise there's a red button, you're not going to be really bothered about it. Many tools just, if you block even a single task, it goes all the way up and blocks the release. So you could kind of, you know, use simple Excels all the way up till post-its to really make things happen. Of course, you're doing Agile, okay, fine. I know Scrum, that's about it. So that's the typical way. And that is also correlated with the survey that recently came from version 1, which says 54% people still use only plain simple Scrum. And XP is very much down at 2%. This is not a very old one. This is actually a 2013 one. Hybrid, which is Scrum, XP, hybrid, some kind of continuous integration I'll do, some code reviews and code refactoring stuff. Whatever I need, I'll do. No harm. It's good. At least these numbers have actually increased from the last year. I've been tracking this, so I know for a fact this was somewhere around 8%, has become 11. So it's 52 became 54, so it's still growing up. And I'm at more or less at the end of the slide. So just telling you that the survey also confirms the biggest bottleneck is the ability to change the organizational culture. And we faced it too. Trying to fit Agile into a non-Agile framework, as you see, the management support is pretty highly rated as the barriers. If you don't have a management support, you're going to be really, really not doing well. Then a lot of other stuff, which is, you know, project complexity, personal right skills, all is fine. But then first thing is changing the people's mindset is one thing that if you really do it, you're more or less won half the battle at that particular instant. For that, you have to show them a lot of value. You have to show them that it's easing their life and not kind of complicating it by making you fill 10 different tools and stuff. This is my summary slide, which talks about saying, if you're an engineer, by any chance, still an engineer, your problems are largely technical, focus on them. Do not worry about too much and use the guiding Agile manifesto and principles. Do collaboration, do all that stuff, meet your PM, talk to them. And then using the Agile planning and estimating techniques, please play an important part when you're doing story planning, story point estimation. Randomly don't give 13, randomly don't give 8. Think about whether it's really an 8 in comparison with something else. You know, just like that, these poker planning games also become like a game because we have called it a game, right? So people just come in and play it a game, but it's not really a game. You are a commitment at the end of the week, end of the sprint planning. Line managers, and again, what's my role? That's a big, Pete has written an article about managers in Scrum. Management is, please insulate the engineers from all the prioritization noise that you're creating. That's a recommendation that I would probably give, saying, you don't need to, right? At the end of the day, he's not going to deliver the value that you are expecting him to deliver, because you're going to be randomizing. That's him or her, which is going to be the thing. So the expert in anything was once a beginner. So please begin now if you haven't. From my perspective, it was a phenomenal journey for us with just 3 people, with 180 to 200 team members, with 80 plus releases. We still made the ship not like a Titanic, but then it moved. It moved really well. Not that I added 10 more people, it would have moved faster. Just a matter of what I'm trying to say is keep things very, very light, visible, I mean, whatever you saw is what really happened. There's no bookish stuff that I've put it in. All the stuff that I've written it is what happened over the last 2 years or 9 months out there. So that's all I had to say today. Hope you enjoyed it. And thanks, Ellen, for providing me the laptop today. Otherwise, I would have probably not been standing in front of you today. Thank you. Have a nice evening.